Today, Donald Trump said he didn't understand why Hillary Clinton left the stage to go to the bathroom when there was a perfectly good election to pee all over. On today's show, Myq Kaplan, Micah Fox, and Frank Conniff. Stay with us.
The David Feldman radio program is made possible by listeners like you. You sad, pathetic humps.
Welcome to the broadcast. I'm David Feldman, davidfeldmanshow.com. Please follow me on Facebook, friend me on Twitter, or is it friend me on Twitter, follow me on Facebook? I can't remember. Wow, what a great show we have. The great Myq Kaplan, Micah Fox, and my hero, Frank Conniff, on today's show. Christmas is around the corner. Steve Forbes will be our guest Christmas Day, so you might want to tune in. Yes, Steve Forbes, the publisher of Forbes magazine, is calling in, so we'll talk with Mr. Steve Forbes. And yes, he's a conservative. You need a crazy uncle at your Thanksgiving dinner and your Christmas dinner? I've invited Steve Forbes, who ran for president in 96 and 2000, and he runs Forbes Media. He's going to be the crazy uncle at our Christmas dinner this year on the David Feldman Show. It should be interesting. Hey, do your shopping on Amazon via the David Feldman Show website. Go to davidfeldmanshow.com. You'll see the Amazon banner. Hit it, shop away, and we get a small percentage, and it keeps the lights on here. I will next week talk to you, my listeners, to thank you for a great year, and I love you all. It's been a difficult year for some of us, but you came through, as always. You're the best. Thank you for supporting this show. Let's get right to it. Myq Kaplan, Micah Fox, and Frank Conniff.
You left 15 minutes.
Micah Fox is the host of This Week in Jackin, where she invites comedians to come on and talk about masturbation.
That's right. The first time they experimented with their body to the most recent and everything in between.
Okay. Myq Kaplan.
Yes.
His new Netflix special is Small, Dark, and Dork and Handsome. And Hang Out With Me is the name of your award-winning podcast.
Oh, yeah. Thank you. Thank you for giving it an award.
It won a Feldy.
Thank you.
And
how come I've never won a Feldy?
It's fixed. Hang Out With Me. And he has a guest coming up named David Feldman.
Yeah, different guy.
Yeah, completely different
guy. So a common name.
Very.
One day I'll play on the show the episode we did with Marc Maron 5 years ago where we were all going to the potties in Las Vegas.
That's fun.
And Frank Conniff will be in Minneapolis opening for the great Liz Winstead New Year's Eve. What theater is that?
Oh, you can go to LizWinstead.com or whatever, you can find out.
So if you live in Minneapolis, yeah, go to Acme Comedy Club.
No, that we're not there that night.
Right. But New Year's Eve, go to see...
I think it's the Cedar Center.
Go
the
to
the place.
Go to Cedars-Sinai Hospital and go to the Cedar Center and go see Liz Winstead, the creator of The Daily Show.
Yes.
With Frank Conniff, who will also be at Sketchfest in San Francisco...
January 15th, I'll be there with Trace Bellew doing our live Mystery Science Theater movie riffing show. And then the next afternoon, I'll be doing John Fugelsang's show, Comedy Nation, which will be there.
And speaking of John Fugelsang, Frank is a regular co-host or sidekick?
No, wacky sidekick.
He is the
wacky co-host.
A lot of
I wouldn't call myself the co-host. John does all the work in terms of that kind of stuff.
You're the vice host.
He doesn't even say hi when you walk in.
Tell me everything on Sirius XM channel.
Channel 121, 2 to 5 every afternoon.
My favorite, whenever I check my calendar and I see that I'm booked on John Fugelsang's show, I always go, it's like that and QED. And Podhouse 90
is my podcast. You can find that at frankconniff.com. It's original radio plays that I write and direct, the latest of which is called the Agoraphobic Action League, about superheroes who are too depressed to leave their apartment. I promise you, it's the least action-packed superhero story ever told.
Great. Well, this is heaven for me. It really is, because everybody here is a virgin. And
wait a second.
No, it doesn't get any better than this. Maybe if there were some coffee that the secretary here at Showbiz Studios would... somebody just gave me the finger. Okay, I need a little coffee, because I taped Myq Kaplan's podcast earlier. And
true.
And so...
Drained yourself of all energy.
Yes. Let's do a year in review. I want to look back at the year in review. Mm-hmm. But before we get to it, because there are
you want to look back at all the year in reviews?
A year in review in review.
I have to bring him up. I have to. I apologize. Donald Trump. I was watching him the other night, and as you said on your show, mm-hmm. he spins the dial. Everybody has something. He has something for everybody. And for me, it's what he's saying about the war in Iraq and how he attacks Jeb Bush and, mm-hmm. and the family to his face, mm-hmm. and says during the debate that the Iraq war's, you know, $3 trillion, mm-hmm. countless lives lost. And to me, that's worth the price of admission. As long as you're not Mexican, black, a woman, Arab, or if you love America, as mm-hmm. long as you don't love America, uh-huh. he's fine. Frank Conniff.
Yes.
Is he going to get the nomination?
I think it's possible he's going to get the nomination. From what I'm seeing, Ted Cruz is starting to do well. The thing is Ted Cruz is the same as Donald Trump. He's just as hateful. Even he's in among Republicans, he's even more hated than Donald Trump. So any one of these Republican becoming nominees is all comedy gold. You know, it's like we don't have to depend on Trump for the rest of the year if he drops out.
Micah Fox.
That's my name.
Are you worried?
What? About what?
Just
Trump?
In general. It's yeah. Your active state.
Well, there was this while I thought I had like a jaw tumor, but it's just an extra bone.
On one side or both?
Well, there's just one, but my private dentist says I could grow another any day.
Your dad?
Yeah, my dad.
Is your dad a dentist?
Well, yeah, he's retired though, so, you know, no freebies.
You do have beautiful teeth.
Oh, thank you.
And do you floss every day?
Yes.
I started.
You know what I started doing? I got a water pick. Oh, yeah. Greatest thing in the world.
Yeah, I hear you can use that in your teeth, too.
Oh, boy. That's what I thought he meant. But then...
Water picks are amazing. In fact...
Ew, I just realized my parents had one in their bedroom.
Isn't that all real?
It's probably just a display model.
I have much better water sports than my parents practiced.
Wait a second.
Yes.
Not
well,
to bring us off topics.
Myq Kaplan.
Yes.
Last night we were at QED.
Oh, yeah.
And a Jew... told us he was voting for Trump.
Big, real Trump supporter.
During but how big of a Jew?
Very Jew.
Seems big.
Yeah.
And it happened towards the end of David's set. It was on my show. And David was like, can I have another minute to delve into this with this fellow? And you were like, are you serious? And he's like, yes. He's like, why? And he's like, because Islam is a dark, dangerous force. It's just a fact that no other religion is like that. And we're like, oh, no. And like the rest of the audience was like, incorrect. What about these Christian things and other such?
Oh,
yeah,
my God.
It's very disheartening because there was an article by, I think it was Dana Milbank in the Washington Post, who is Jewish, and he attacked Trump. And then his last column was the comments that he received for attacking Trump, and he was called a kike and a yid, and the Jews control everything.
Say them all.
Yeah. And how you cannot see, if you're Jewish, how you cannot see that when they're done with the Muslims, you're
black
on
people.
Deck.
And then
the opposite right. of...
You would think a Hitler-esque figure might worry you if you're a Jew.
Godwin's law. If you bring up Hitler, you've lost the argument.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I heard that. I didn't even know what that
Shouldn't
Godwin's
it be called
law was.
Hitler's law?
Because I did a tweet and I said that it, and I was very sincere about this. I said it's now irresponsible to not compare Trump to Hitler. Because, it's like the thing you're not supposed to do. Don't compare. But the parallels with Hitler. With Trump are very stark. I think he wants to round people up. He wants to send them away,
let me play Hitler's advocate. Seriously.
That's the name of your magazine, isn't it?
It's like for
it's gay
men.
The gay Nazi magazine.
Hitler's advocate.
Oh, I used to put that on my walls as a child. the Center magazine rip-offs.
In the privacy of my own home,
mm-hmm.
I watch Trump and I giggle because I feel safe right now. And I find him to be really funny. And how close is he to,
there's no telling now because there hasn't been an election yet.
But he's talking about killing reporters. Like, I don't want to kill a reporter, but there are a couple.
And he wants to kill the families of Muslims. And he doesn't want to let Muslims into the country. I mean, he's just,
Does he really mean this?
Who cares if it doesn't matter if he means it or not. He's saying it and he's running on it and he's appealing to people who believe it and who want someone to say that stuff.
Yeah, usually people will do things a lot worse than what they're saying.
Yeah.
They're not saying one thing and then not, they're doing way worse.
Yeah.
If he's saying he's going to round up Muslims, what he means is like he's just going to like blast off the planet and blow everything up behind him.
Yeah.
But here's the thing. I think so far the numbers are like he has, a chunk of support, but he also has almost an equal number of Republicans who are like, I'll never vote for him.
Right.
I'd vote for Hillary before him. And if you look at the whole voting population, there's a much smaller percentage of people who would ever consider voting for him. So I imagine that he will not win. And then when a Democrat wins, he'll be like, I helped. Like, I did it. This was my plan all along. I was a Democrat years ago. And we did it, guys. Like, he'll just spin it like that. And I honestly think that could be the truth. But he's also just like, I'm making money. People are looking at me. Like, that's all he cares
about.
Yeah,
it's the attention is what he loves more than anything. I don't think he might not necessarily really even want to be president. But this is like the greatest time of his life right now. That everyone in the country is talking about him, paying attention to him. The media is fawning all over him. The media, I've never seen it before where a guy, he won't even show up at the studio. They do mostly telephone interviews with him.
Because of his hair.
No, I
don't. Seriously. He can't, it's a lot of work to
I would guess,
comb.
But I remember when he hosted SNL, which was the best show out of 30 Rock since Hitler hosted the Kraft Music Hall. But
that was 30 Reich.
He was there the very next morning, Meet the Press, which is done in the same building. They had him for a phone interview. He wouldn't even come back. He lives like three blocks away.
Why is the reason you're saying?
Huh?
Why isn't he doing things in person?
He's because the media is his bitch. That's
no, it's because of his hair. I'm telling you,
no.
It takes 2 hours for him to get his hair ready. So he rather, I'm telling, look at that hair. You know how long it?
His hair to me, every time I write a tweet about Trump, someone writes a joke about his hair. About his hair.
But I'm telling you, that's why he does the phone interviews.
What, I don't understand how it could take 2 hours to do that.
Yeah.
That doesn't make it, in 2 hours you couldn't make it look believable?
Rip Taylor got ready in a half hour. Come on.
Let's
can I say one more thing about Trump?
Yeah.
Final thing from me. I'm not going to dictate anybody else. It's like, you know, like, there's, I feel like, a certain kind of movie where a bad character, like an evil, like a gangster or something, like, gets away with everything, and he's like, aha, and then I have a new identity, you can't, and then he's, like, lives a boring life the rest of his life, and he's miserable even though he got away with everything that he wanted. That would be, like, the ultimate ending if Trump did get the presidency, but actually didn't, and he's like, Like, I just wanted to be on TV and say, say wacky bullshit.
Do words have consequences, Myq Fox?
I believe that they do.
Nope.
Oh, okay. Well, that was fast. I guess my words did not have consequence in that scenario.
Yep.
Well, I wonder how many people are encouraged to torch mosques because of what Donald Trump is saying.
It could be.
Yep.
You know.
All right. Let's do the 2015
year. I feel like I got trapped into a soundbite. Well, Myq says Trump's going to burn some mosques and on to the news.
I had no idea that Myq Fox was hosting a Draw Muhammad contest this week.
Well, that actually is going to be a lot of fun, David.
Save the drama for Muhammad.
Okay. January 7th. Now, I don't mean to brag. I don't mean to brag. But on January, I'm not bragging about this, but on January 7th of 2015, two gunmen, Saeed and Sharif Kouachi, attacked the Paris offices of the French satirical magazine Charlie Hebdo, wounding 11 and killing 12.
Mm-hmm.
That was a horrible, horrible thing that happened.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, but, and amazing that one of them was killed without being wounded.
Yes. Good point.
My God.
You're right. That wounding 11 and killing 12.
Very confusing.
There's different people.
Got it. Now on board.
Oh, okay. But we're going to play a clip of what I said on January 6th. I was talking to Frank Conniff. Listen to this clip. Uh-oh. Can you play it, Alex?
I don't want to hear my quote, whatever it was.
Hey, Frank, how you doing?
Hey, David. Great to be here in January.
It's
in
January 6th. It's kind of unseasonably cold. Hey, I have a bad feeling about this Charlie Hebdo. I think three gunmen, this is tomorrow, three gunmen are going to shoot up Charlie Hebdo, wounding 12 and killing 14.
Really? Wow. I wish I had a joke about that.
But, well, I don't think it's funny. We shouldn't make, let's just pray I'm wrong. That was the clip from, I said that on January 6th, and I got the numbers wrong, but I did get that right in a way.
David, this is amazing.
A powerful gift.
Yes.
What are you doing with it?
And where were you on the next Paris attack?
Anyway, that's just a interesting. Anyway,
I predicted that a Glamour magazine would get shot up.
I predicted that Shot magazine would get glamoured up. Could that mean a thing?
I predicted we'd get glamour shots.
What, are we playing word ball now?
We're playing bird wall now.
On February 26th of 2015, marijuana use and the possession of up to 2 ounces of the drug became legal in Washington, D.C.
Mm-hmm.
Myq Fox.
Wait.
We hold people accountable on this show.
Yes.
Okay? On February 26th, marijuana use of up to 2 ounces of the drug became legal in Washington, D.C. You were on the show February 20th. Do you remember? I'm going to play a clip now.
It's a little hate. Yeah, oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
I mean, you got this completely wrong. Let's, Alex, can we play the clip of Myq Fox?
La, 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 la.
Now, Myq, Christmas had been over for, what, 2 months?
2 months.
I think it's important to keep the spirit year-round.
But, I mean, you still have your Christmas decorations.
That's right. I'm not even Christian. I think that's the lesson that we should really take away from the holiday.
That everybody.
Yes. Christmas is in your heart, not in a religion.
On March 2nd. The New York Times reported that during her time as Secretary of State, Hillary Clinton was using her personal email for official business. House Republicans began an investigation. This was March 2nd that we became aware of this.
Was I on the show?
You were on the show March 3rd, the day after.
And I predicted that yesterday. Oh, can we do the clip?
Let's play the clip.
So yesterday, I think Hillary Clinton sent a business email. No, a personal email from her business account. That's what I think happened.
And that was the clip. And that was amazing that you got that. How did you get that right the next day?
I don't know. I wasn't really listening.
And I was part of the mainstream media mob that predicted that because of this, Hillary's Clinton would Hillary Clinton's campaign would be over by the end of the year. And that is actually what a lot of mainstream media people were giving the impression of, that she, that this was going to doom her campaign. And guess what? That didn't turn out to be the case.
You're a Hillary supporter.
I am. And I'm also, I also hate the mainstream media. But
you're doing our benefit to keep Hillary honest, aren't you?
What benefit is that? I never heard about that.
The 29th of...
January. It's on that piece of paper.
Oh, can I have this piece of paper, please? On January 29th at 7 p.m., Frank Conniff, John Fugelsang, David Feldman, and somebody else.
Judy Gold.
No, that's... I'm at Caroline's with her this week. Oh, by the way, I'm at Caroline's with Judy Gold.
Well, by the way, that benefit... Hillary is very upset about that, as someone from Bernie Sanders' campaign told me as they read things.
The joke makes sense.
January 29th at QED in Astoria at 7 p.m. We're doing a benefit with John Fugelsang, uh-huh. And you're going to be there.
Who's the benefit for?
It's to keep Hillary honest. It's to raise money for Bernie Sanders.
Oh, it's a Bernie Sanders
benefit.
Well, stage time is stage time.
I'm sorry, it's for Trump.
Stage time is stage time.
So are you willing to admit who you want to vote for? Or?
Sure.
Who would you vote for?
I don't know yet, though.
I'm going to write in Micah.
Yeah, thanks, Mike. I'm going to write in me, too.
Yeah.
You haven't made up your mind?
No, I mean, I guess I haven't voted in a very long time. I'm going to be honest. I've lost a lot of faith in the system, and I usually forget when election day is.
First Tuesday in November.
You know, but every year.
Yeah.
I guess it'd be Hillary or Bernie, but... I don't know yet.
You've lost faith in the system.
Yeah, I don't... Yeah, ever... Well, Bush stole the presidency 2000, and it's been a shit show since then.
Yes,
it was a shit show before then, but it was really a mockery then. And I was just like, you know, I wasn't, like, allowed to vote yet, but I was just watching it like, come on.
Well, I thought they gave the vote to women in the 20s.
Ha.
Well, yes, but I was under 18.
Not in 2000.
Well, let me get these facts back to you.
That was the first one you could have voted in.
Wait a second. Damn it, maybe it was my fault.
Yeah.
Wait a second, you were 18?
No, I guess I wasn't. I guess I could vote, and I think I did.
Do you know that my career was over by the time you were, like, ready to start yours?
Yep, and look what we've done with ourselves.
When was your first time you did comedy?
Stand-up? I did it once, with like, and then didn't do it for a long time, but it was in, I want to say, 2000.
Mm-hmm.
Wow. No, 2003. That's what it was.
Okay.
Yeah.
And then when did you start doing it, like, more seriously?
Like, 2006.
Oh, okay. Well, we're glad you did.
Thank you.
And then when did you start doing it, like, more comedically?
Oh, you know, somewhere around last year.
Yeah, you're good.
Christmas is this Friday.
Uh-huh.
True.
Or Saturday. Isn't it Saturday?
No, it's Friday.
Oh, it's Friday? Okay.
Three Jews had to tell you, Frank Conniff, when Christmas is.
It's in your heart year-round.
See, that's why I have a blockage.
Right.
That's
I know it's Christmas.
You should really go to the hospital, yeah. Though.
Can you take out the Christmas spirit from my heart? I think it got Grinchy in there.
What is a perfect Christmas for you?
Oh... for me, a perfect Christmas is one where I'm not really thinking about it being Christmas or the holidays. And the thing for me, Christmas Day is not a problem. Like, I usually go see my brother and my nieces and nephew, and it's very pleasant. It's everything leading up to it that I have a problem that triggers my tendency to be depressed anyway. Kind of gets exacerbated by the Christmas season. Although this year I've been okay, though.
Myq
doesn't
Kaplan.
Sound like a blockage at all to me.
Perfect You're? Christmas.
Yes.
I like being with a loved one and watching Love Actually, a thing I've never done.
Oh, God. I was like, ugh.
But we'll do this Friday.
No.
Or won't.
Well, you know what? You should know what's out there.
I don't know.
Did you poison wells with your family on Christmas Day as a Jew?
Of course.
Did you do that?
We were usually too sluggish after drinking children's blood.
What's your favorite type? What do you like to do on Christmas?
Well, I guess I take my lottery winnings and I fly away and I don't tell anybody.
Mm-hmm. Every year.
Well, this is an ideal Christmas.
The perfect one.
Right, yeah. Perfect Christmas.
What's the worst Christmas you ever spent?
Oh, I got last year. Last year was pretty bad.
What happened?
I got in a fight with my boyfriend at his friend's party, and that's weird as hell, And I was like, oh, this. I don't even celebrate Christmas. This is mm-hmm. bullshit.
Favorite Christmas song? I'll tell you mine.
Okay, you start first.
Do They Know It's Christmas? Seriously.
Start first.
The one about the famine?
Oh, isn't that a Passover one?
Well, that's one of the plagues.
Oh, all right.
But Do They Know It's Christmas?
Do They Know It's Christmas? That's what me and my boyfriend got in a fight about, actually.
Do They Know It's Christmas
right.
time?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's nice.
That's my favorite Christmas song. What's your favorite Christmas song?
Oh, yeah, that one.
That's what you wanted to go first.
What's your favorite Christmas song?
Oh, I like a lot of them. I like Carol of the Bells.
Of course you would. It sounds like 101110.
What is this?
The one that goes...
That sounds like it's digital.
101110.
It's wow. digital.
He's a robot. Mm-hmm.
I like things.
101110.
Guys, what's your favorite analog?
Merry Christmas from Myq Kaplan.
This would hurt my feelings if I had any. Come on, guys.
What's your favorite?
We're gonna program some for you.
Christmas song.
I guess the one that I like. Can I say that I like least? Little Drummer Boy. That one.
Yeah, that's not
doesn't do it
good.
For me.
Yeah, and I usually like drum things.
Yeah, you know? Drums are good.
Yeah.
I like Silent Night. It's kind of nice.
And Frank?
My thing is I don't like any of the religious ones. I like the secular Christmas songs. And I really like the Christmas Waltz, which Frank Sinatra does. And the Frank Sinatra Christmas album, by the way, is a really good album. Mm-hmm. And I like, Let It Snow and...
Jingle Bells?
No, I like the ones that are like Let It Snow. I think that's by Jimmy Van Heusen and Sammy Kahn. It's like I like the Christmas songs that are written by real songwriters and are
not
just
you
good songs.
Phony Christmas song hacks. Yeah.
Well, they're all written by Jews, actually. Yeah. White Christmas being the most famous example.
Oh, yeah.
It was supposed to be Aryan Christmas, but
the Christmas Waltz is very jazzy, and it's got a swing.
I like the Charlie Brown Christmas
music.
Yeah,
that's great music. I totally agree.
Do you think you'd like it if you didn't have it accompanying the movie growing up?
No, I honestly think I would
keep going while we're talking. Keep talking. Go ahead, Frank.
Would like the Charlie Brown Christmas movie, regardless of whether I'd watch the.
There's no way to prove this, Frank.
I think if you know me and my musical taste, I think I could prove it.
Well, we'll never know.
Does it bother
Come
you?
Come on, Lucy.
Does it bother you that Burl Ives names before the House Un-American Activities Committee?
That does bug me. But I'm a fan. I enjoy the work of several people who sang like canaries during the A. Burroughs, one of the greatest comedy writers of all time, named names at the House Un-American. Bud Schulberg, who, and then he went on to write On the Waterfront, which is a movie I love, which is a movie that completely justifies Elia Kazan, another informer that completely justifies giving testimony and ratting on your friends.
Do you know On the Waterfront is a movie that only two other movies have done the same thing that movie did? Do you know what that thing is?
What is that?
It won all five of the top Academy Award categories.
I don't think that's true in the case of On the Waterfront.
Fair enough.
The six best turncoat.
What's the movie that I get confused with On the Waterfront that's older?
Well, I can tell you, being the loser that I am, I know the two movies that have won all five major categories.
Let me see if I can guess.
There are three. There are definitely three.
Gone with the Wind.
Nope.
Nope, not Gone with
Ben-Hur.
The Wind.
What are the two that you know?
Nope.
The two that I can tell you for sure.
Yep.
It happened one night.
That is the one that I get
Clark
confused.
Clark Gable, Claudine Colbert, director Frank Zappa, screenwriter Robert Riskin, and then also
Frank Zappa?
No, Frank Capra.
I heard Zappa
and the
too.
Italian Mothers of Invention. And and also the One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest.
And also Silence of the Lambs.
Really?
Yep. No, who did, there was no best actress. Oh, you're right. No.
There was.
Yeah, you're
Jodie
right.
Foster. Jodie Foster. Yeah. They didn't want to give her best actress at that time.
Oh, we're come on. These are nice people here.
We're much more advanced now about those kind of things.
Yeah, I always get confused on the waterfront and It Happened One Night because they're movies that I haven't seen.
Both are great movies. Cool. I recommend both of them.
Thank
Worst
you.
Commercial that they repeat over and over is that effing Lexus commercial.
Any commercial where someone gets a car I've never even heard of that. I've even known some rich people. I don't even heard of them doing that.
You can't
Here,
spell.
Honey, you didn't want to help make this decision. You don't want to know anything about this huge purchase.
And yeah, if you're like, I think rich people don't, you know, like they're probably into like more elaborate things than just putting a bow on top of a car, you know, and hand.
No, this car is going to drive us to your new helicopter.
But here's the thing I don't understand. It's the same Lexus commercial, but don't they change the model of the Lexus each year? Is it a different?
Probably, yeah.
I'm sure they do.
Same family, though. Rich, rich, rich.
Yes.
Is it? No, I don't know.
They trade it in every year.
But I sit there with, you know, the ice cream on my belly, and I just want those people dead.
Yeah,
I just want to phone in a drone
strike.
Christmas
season in general is a good time to not watch TV or listen to the radio or leave your house because you'll have to go into shopping malls where you'll be reminded of everything.
You know? A question for the Jews.
Yep, I'm ready.
Okay. Frank, let's see if you can get the correct answer here because you're the only Gentile.
Question
here.
From the Jews.
From the Jews. Let's see if he gets the right answer. When is it, which is worse to go to a Chinese restaurant? On Yom Kippur or Christmas?
I don't know. In L.A., I used to be quite fond of going to a Genghis Cohen restaurant on Christmas Eve. But I've never been to a Chinese restaurant on Yom Kippur, so I wouldn't know that.
The best time to go to a Chinese restaurant is on Yom Kippur. Why? Say it, you anti-Semite. The answer is no Jews.
Yes. It's a beautiful Jewish.
Oh, you see, I'm so out of the Jewish loop, I didn't even know that.
That's when Jews don't eat.
I knew it. Did you know?
I thought maybe that's the day they do go to eat. You know, I didn't even know.
No, that's
I mean, you'll get the secular Jews who don't care about fasting.
And happen to love Chinese food, which is a perfect Venn diagram of Jews and Chinese food.
And the worst time to go to a Chinese restaurant?
Probably when they haven't had any new food deliveries in a while.
After the apocalypse.
Christmas Day.
That's a bad time to go?
Yes.
Why?
Jews.
Oh, okay.
A lot of Jews at Chinese restaurants.
Yeah, I'm aware of that.
You know what, though? That's when you should go, because the people who work will be so annoyed by the Jews, they'll be happy to see you.
Enjoyed going to Genghis Cohen. They treat me.
Extra crispy noodles for right this there. Gentile. Yeah.
This is how I order at a Chinese restaurant on Christmas Day. I would like to first send back the spicy tofu. And then
should have never let me order that, by the way.
Then we should. Do you want to try sending back? Should we split sending back the veggie dumplings?
That's great.
Christmas is a tough time of the year, right?
So then on March 3rd, I don't know if we're still doing this.
Yeah, well, Benjamin Netanyahu addressed Congress at the invitation of House Speaker John Boehner.
Yeah, I remember that.
What was the, this year, I was asked, John Fugelsang asked me what the big story was, gave me some choices.
Gay marriage?
Oh, no.
That was a big story.
I thought you were proposing.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. What do you want to do?
Let's go. I think you and I would be compatible. I think you and I would make a good husband and husband.
Mike, this is not the time to be demure.
Oh.
No. No, thanks.
Oh, no, I meant go for it.
Oh.
Gay marriage. What was the big story for you?
Rachel Dolezal. Dolezal for the win. Best story of the year. She's the perfect intersection of major stories. She's the Caitlyn Jenner story came out, and everyone's like relating, you know, because she's a white woman pretending to be black, and so isn't maybe Caitlyn Jenner just a man pretending to be a woman? Who knows? And then it's also.
But that's not the Dolezal story isn't interesting without the Caitlyn Jenner story.
I disagree because it also brings up a lot of interesting conversations about race and about blackface in general, and what does it mean to be black. So without Caitlyn Jenner, it's highly interesting. And the fact that she was president of her chapter of the NAACP and they were fine with it until she was outed. How about the fact that her parents sold her out? And
that was the worst part of the whole thing, I
thought. Interesting thing about this is how it exposes big makeup for the frauds that they are and the lies they've been perpetrating on women for centuries.
Centuries?
Myq, I wouldn't expect a man to understand this.
I do think it's a more interesting story, but I don't think it's as important.
So she was the woman, I believe, from Seattle, and she was president.
Yeah, she was in Tacoma or
somewhere in the Northwest.
Yeah, and she was head of her NAACP division. And
she taught African-American studies as well. Mm-hmm. Is that true?
She studied that in college. Mm. And I don't know if, I don't remember if she taught it, but she also taught African hair braiding
techniques.
Wow. She knew her stuff.
Her hair looked great.
If race is a thing you can become, she did it.
Right. She also did have like 4 black siblings.
They were adopted.
That she was raised in a house with black family members, you know, not biological family members, but
her parents
culturally speaking. No, yeah, that's true.
Once you've pretended to be black, you won't go back.
So, wait a second. I kind of defend her.
Rachel Dolezal? I've been pro Dolezal since the get.
Well, I mean, actually, because I haven't followed it as closely as you, but I just thought she was a punchline, but now that you talk about this, was she thrown off the NAACP?
Yeah, she was. She was. I mean, there was a lot of bad publicity that was not for the advancement their cause. You know,
they had no choice but to.
But they did not. They did not dislike her. There's still a lot of people there who will sing her praises. She was doing important work. Obviously,
she turned a lot of white people black in her work.
A lot of obviously this is a very like touchy issue.
Well, what does it mean
black people and you know like how that feels to have their culture?
What does it mean to be black? Answered by 4 people who are definitely not black.
Yeah.
I mean, that's the main issue is that she was, you know, the job that she was doing was, you know, if everybody knew, once they knew, they're like, oh, probably a black person, or, you know, the question of what is a black person is an important question that people who are definitely black have the most say in, I would say.
So you're not defending her?
I'm not attacking her. I don't know her and her intentions. And because I am not of the relevant community, like by almost any means, you know, other than, you know, Jews are an oppressed people in some ways that I, you know, I'm a fortunate person. I'm a privileged person in so many ways in my appearance and my life circumstances that the point is, like, if you could become another race, it doesn't mean that you and your family and your circumstances, like, there's so many things that go in that get wrapped up in, you know, race and class and, you know, economic and social status and geographic things. And, like, so many things that if the criticism of her is like, hey, you're just coming on and getting the good stuff, potentially. I mean,
yeah, it's hard enough for black people to get a job, and now you're taking the one guaranteed job. <Yeah. laughs>
But so, I think it would be totally cool of her, and there'd be nothing wrong if she, for anyone who's white or any race, can just, if you want to embrace black culture and have black culture all around you and have all the things you'd be into kind of like that, which is actually kind of what our society is just black. All of culture almost is things developed by black people that got assimilated into the mainstream. But if you want to do all that and you really want to be so immersed in black culture, I think that's fine. It's just don't say that you're black.
There's a lot of controversy there too, because she applied for scholarships as a minority, which you know is like,
that's
incredibly
questionable.
It's beyond questionable. It's like incredibly unfair. Sometimes like she denies that happened, and I think some of the evidence is a little muddy. I remember thinking that it was real, that she did do that. She went to Howard University, which is traditionally a black college. I think there is a question here of did she steal it? I think she has some kind of mental issue where she thinks She is black. She is not faking this.
Like when she was at, there's that famous sort of, you know, clip of her being asked, like, are your parents, like she was asked something very specific and easy, and she was like, didn't seem like she could answer
it. And her parents are the fucking worst. You know, yeah. I think we can just establish that, that whatever her background was, growing up with these people was just awful. And this is kind of how her dysfunction manifested itself. And there are far worse ways that something like that could matter. But the thing that really put it over the edge was when it came out that she was, at one point, she was married to Robert De Niro.
What was your big story of the year, Frank?
Well, I don't know what my I didn't personally have a big story this year, but from what some people are saying, it might be the climate change summit in Paris. You know, maybe ultimately in the long term that might, because it's hard in the year when you're living in the year, it's hard to say what is the thing that's going to have the most far-reaching consequences. Trump is. Obviously, as a comedian who does topical material, he was probably the person that I talked about more than anything else or did more jokes about.
Oh, I thought you were saying that Trump was a...
Trump, as a political comedian, yeah. Trump, yeah.
Yeah.
But, you know, so, you know, for me, doing, being interested in politics the way I am and doing comedy about it and tweets about it, the 2016 primary, the Republican primary was kind of, I think, what I was most involved with.
Back to the climate change. Summit.
Yeah, I think that the climate change summit, though, may be, you know, when they look back at this year, they may say that was the thing that happened that had real. I'm hoping that that's what happens, that they look back and say that's what had real historic significance. And by the way, in the Democratic debate. On Saturday, there was no questions about climate change from the moderators. And she, Martha Raddatz, asked them about their spouses and didn't ask about Planned Parenthood or reproductive rights or climate change. So I think it's just an example of how frivolous the media is.
Yeah.
You know.
Myq Kaplan?
Gay marriage still. I'm still on gay marriage.
Okay. I would say...
Oh, do you want me to talk about that?
Yeah, right. I would say I would agree with you, but I have something. I'll tell you what mine is. We were talking about gay marriage last night, but he said no.
Ha.
It's kind of what I did with you earlier. It's not that funny.
No, I like it.
It's funnier when it's not him, though.
Yeah. I'm fine either way.
You know, I was talking to a friend about having sexual urges and not being able to fulfill them. And it must be very difficult. I'm pretending to be straight here.
Okay.
To have homosexual urges and have to keep it under wraps all the time. Mm-hmm. And until gay marriage, it's like, what gay marriage does is it's not that they're able to get married. There are some things we talked about, being able to visit your loved ones and the will and all that. But it's the state saying, it's okay to be gay. It's sanctioning how you choose to love. That's what was lost on me until recently, is that it was the state saying it's okay to be gay.
It's more the practical things that if you're not married, then in order to have somebody else be your, you know, power of attorney and be able to visit you and, you know, inherit your things and not pay, you know, all the like logistical bureaucratic things that, you know, straight people who can get married take for granted. Like, I don't even care about, like, Doug Stanhope used to have a joke about, he's like, should gay marriage be a thing? And people would be like, woo. And he'd be like, no marriage should be a thing. Mm-hmm. Like, marriage, why, you know, and then there's funny things, but. Like, I don't care specifically, but if there is marriage, then it has to be fair. If two people can do a thing, then any two people or three, you know, I think it should be next, you know.
Right.
So multi-person marriages.
The story for me of the year was Black Lives Matter's interrupting Bernie Sanders because it forced me to really think.
Mm-hmm. Sure. You're like, I like both of these.
Mm-hmm.
But and they don't like each other.
I still, to this day, say that that was a bad move on the part of Black Lives Matter to do that.
Why? Why do you say?
Because I think it's of all the people in the world who are the problem if the Black Lives Matter, if the issues that Black Lives Matter are into is important to you. Of all the people in the world who are your problem, Bernie Sanders, like, is way down on that list as far as I'm concerned. And it's just counterproductive for the left. And the left has a history of doing this, where they just circle the wagons and fire at each other. I didn't really see what was productive about that.
It changed me because I had that first, exactly what you said. But then I talked to people, and what I realized is racism, what I've learned this year is that racism is different from class warfare. And that while Bernie is saying the things that really sing to me about, you know, the richest 1% and income inequality, there is a separate issue of race that white people don't always get. And it's been evidenced.
I agree with that, but I don't think protesting Bernie Sanders is the way to express that.
Right, but he did then address the issue of race. He wasn't really talking about race. There's a I know this is... Earlier, Mikey and I were talking.
He was the only one that was maybe going to listen to them. Do you think that was it?
Well, I think that you had said on your show about a comic who, why are you always talking about race? It's
Hari Kondabolu. He has a bit about, like, what people always ask me, why are you talking about race so much? He's like, that'd be like asking a drowning man, why are you always talking about life preservers?
Right. And I have to say that for me, this year, I kind of am taking back something I said about 7 years ago. I gave an interview with a book called Satiristas.
Sure.
And I said...
I have yet to be considered a satirista.
But. Yes. And I said, and I take this back now, I said, you know, I'm tired of hearing women talking about being women and Black people talking about being Black and French people talking about being French.
Can we all just talk about being me?
Yeah, right. And I was wrong. I just didn't get it. You know, I wish I could take those words back. I think then again, you know, when I'm in the clubs and somebody's up on stage who is gay and talking about being gay, there's a part of me that goes, can you talk about something other than being gay?
But it's all dependent on if you're being are you funny? If you have really funny stuff to say about being gay or being Black or whatever, then, you know, then say. I mean, we all in the 80s doing comedy, I mean, there were a million like hacky Black comics who weren't funny.
One of them was named Hacky Black Comic.
He was. And he's currently
That's why I keep getting rejected every time I try to use it as a username.
You know, but when someone is funny talking about who they are, whether if they're Black or if they're gay, then or if they're a woman or whatever, then please keep talking about that because you're really making me laugh.
Like, look at, you know, Kamau Bell is an example of a person that when people ask me about, you know, hey, what do you think about this thing that relates to being Black? I'd be like, listen to Kamau. He probably talked about it because he talks extensively about like things in, you know, new, original, smart, different ways every time. You know, every time I see him do comedy or, you know, when he had a show. And like there's people like it's hard to do comedy, you know, like look at 1,000 white guys doing comedy and most of them are probably look back through your experience and then think about how many of them are, you know, brilliant and original compared to how many of them are talking about things that other people of their type have talked about in ways that are equally, you know, not to your liking or what. But you don't know. Yeah, obviously you don't care. Like, you know, you watch an open mic full of like one woman and nine guys, and you're like, the woman, she wasn't that great, but there was like eight guys that weren't that great. But you're like, looks like women aren't doing it, you know. People just have, you know, the whatever availability heuristics in their brain kick in. And
does heuristics mean?
It's like a way of, like, the availability heuristic means that you take what's available to you, not taking into account what you're not seeing. Like, so people being like, vegans, they're always telling me that they're vegan, but they don't take into account the fact that there could be 1,000 vegans that didn't tell them because they didn't tell them.
But that's not true. All vegans tell you.
No, Frank!
And the movie The Heuristocrats?
Yes, that's...
What was that about? Tell me what that... I never saw The Heuristocrats.
It's all about the shit you didn't sit on.
Micah Fox.
Mm-hmm. You're nailing it. You're two for two.
That is your name.
Yes.
Yeah.
Female comedians.
Oh, yeah. Let's dig.
What's the deal with them?
Why can't they be men?
Why can't a woman?
They can. Some of them can.
Yeah.
Are we doomed? Are men as comics doomed 8 years from now?
I think you should be. I would not have a problem if, like, for just starting today, I didn't hear another man comic for like a year.
Uh-huh.
I think that wouldn't hurt comedy at all.
Go on.
I would be very comfortable. I wouldn't miss it. We'd all fill in the gaps. There'd be a lot of great entertainment. And yeah, you guys have had an opportunity to talk. I think, you know, I don't know if you're doomed, but I wouldn't have a problem if you were.
Mike, I'll take it from here.
Okay.
So the thing about women.
I'm up against this. There's a relationship I have with a very special friend, woman, daughter, whatever.
She's listening and she wants a title, David.
Yeah. Well,
friend, woman, daughter.
How angry should a woman in comedy be? Given,
I think everyone in comedy is either like really angry or ridiculously happy to like to come up with jokes. You're the one person who made me say that.
Uh-huh.
to even want to do this, you'd have to be angry about a lot of things to the point where now you're like, how do I make people listen? Oh, by being funny. Now, you know,
right.
I think.
Describe the marketplace to me. Is there a...
Well, it is a place... Sorry, I'm not going to do it. Just
many
go on.
Fruits.
Right. Yes, thanks. Great.
It's where you can get letters of transit to get out of Casablanca.
That's just like Love Actually, that movie, to me, because I haven't seen either of them.
Oh, you haven't seen Love Actually?
No, I have. All right.
Oh, okay. Yeah, you're our woman after all.
Yes.
Yeah, I mean, men are not as funny right now as women.
I'm
just patronizing.
Okay,
you.
I was like, I don't think that's... Yeah,
that when you should like... be matronizing.
Loves it.
I got him.
He loves it.
That was great. Well, but yeah, I mean,
well, there's never been more comedians, period, and now there's never been more access to people with different web series and podcasts and Twitter channels and Tumblrs and books, and I'll keep using my fingers and counting things up. And then when I run out of fingers, then, you know, anyway. But so we have so much. People are like, you know, there's no good TV shows. Some people say things like that. Or there's no good this or no good that. Compared to 20 years ago, look at, we had all these. And then they name, like, the best things that came out in a 10-year period. But like Frank said, with, like, you know, picking the best thing of the year, when you're in the year, like, we see 1,000 things now at once that in 10 years, like, there were so many horrible TV shows in the 80s that we just don't think about because we don't remember them because they weren't good. They weren't memorable. So who cares? Same thing, like, now you could name, you go out every night and see 1,000 comedians in the course of a year in New York City and be like, man, a lot of male comedians are no good. But then, you know, in 10 years, we'll be like, who are the best comedians then? And you won't remember the bad ones.
It will always be men.
There are so many more bad male comedians than bad, like, straight male comedians, straight white male comedians than any other type.
I did not, that was David saying and mocking me.
Go ahead. What?
That men aren't as funny as women right now.
Well, Alex Brazil and I have been talking about this, and when we go to comedy clubs and watch, it's usually the woman who we end up being fascinated by. That they're.
Mm-hmm.
Why is that?
I have a theory.
Go ahead.
Micah, do you want to tell him my theory?
You know what? I think you say it better.
Well, here's the thing that... One thing that happens in comedy, like, in the past, you know, sort of decade or so, is that, like, diversity has been, you know, desirable in a way that...
Identity comedy has supplanted just a white guy who's clever.
You know, in my case, it's a secret identity.
What do you mean by fascinated?
It just seems that women are more interesting to watch... Well, then again,
I know, but also, and you'll back me up on this, that, like, when you're on stage, what the thing that you really want from an audience member is not necessarily laughter,
right,
but just them going,
fascination.
I'm fascinated by what I'm looking at right now.
Yeah, because people are fascinated by porn, too, so...
They're still
are. Oh, wait a second. That's what I was talking about.
Yes, I thought so. There we go.
I always like watching the woman in porn. Yeah, I... legitimately, I think there are still a bunch of, you know, say, like, I'd say most bookers are male, and historically, like, male bookers have probably been sexist to the point that they're like, we can only put one woman on the show.
I would say it's true of female bookers, too.
Okay, that bookers in general have been like, oh, like, people are used to, like, the male, the straight white male is, like, the default. So, like, we're going to have a bunch of those because there's so many of those. So we'll have, you know, one person, like, on Premium Blend, they would have always one, like, white dude. Then they would have, like, a black person or a non-white dude. And then they'd have a woman. Then so they're like, but there's so many men. So that we have to have them.
It's the curly fry in your basket of regular French fries.
And I think what a woman is going to come up against.
Are you impressed with my metaphorical acumen?
A woman is going to come up against is a booker going,
we ordered the French fries.
We have a woman already in the show.
Yeah. But and if they only have in their mind and on, you know, logistically one spot for a woman, then theoretically it should be if there are so many more funny women than there is one spot, so it's gonna be a super funny woman. So that's why you would see a funny woman on a show if there is only one.
That makes sense. Sure, I don't disagree with that.
I did the math.
Mm-hmm.
I'm a man.
Yeah.
Kind of.
What? Go ahead.
No, you go ahead.
No, I was clearing my throat.
So, Trump, can you understand how men are threatened by losing? Like, we were on a perch, and now we're losing it.
Yeah, you should be terrified. You should be goddamn terrified. We're, you know, like, you had everything. You have nowhere to go but down. Why wouldn't you be scared of that? You have everything.
You're teasing me, but it's...
No, I'm being completely serious. I don't think you should be terrified. I think you should suck it up and just march forward like we all do, you know?
Right.
But yeah, you're going to lose some shit. You're going to maybe lose the White House. You're going to lose some seats in Congress. You're going to have to go to a woman as your doctor, and she's going to stick her finger up your butt for an exam, and
that
you're
going
to have to think
Can
about
you give
that.
Me an address?
Right. you joke, but, you know...
I mean,
I do have a female doctor, and she did stick her finger on my butt, and now she doesn't write, she doesn't call.
Her handwriting was anyway.
So if you're a, how does a man cope with this?
By being
sense
glad
of privilege.
For progress.
How do you deal with your sense of privilege?
Our loss of privilege.
Well, you buy guns, David. You got to stock up on some guns. And take your privilege and move it out into a shack in the woods and keep your nuclear family like it was and, start over somewhere with a new civilization. I mean, what do you know?
Just a bunch of dudes.
Or you know, you could just keep working hard and maybe you won't get as, some of you won't get as far. Which is what's really going to happen.
Did something happen 4 years ago? Did women... Wake
I was
up.
Like, certainly.
No. Year in review 4 years ago. Much shorter show.
Did something happen 4 years ago? I've mentioned this on the show. That 4 years ago, women had a meeting. And they decided...
Wait, when did Inside Amy Schumer come out?
About then, yeah.
When did 30 Rock... Because, I mean, we've been around.
I know, but is there... 4 years ago after Rush Limbaugh revealed that he didn't understand how birth control worked, and the Aiken talking about women being able to shut down
right.
a rape and not get pregnant. Did it become apparent to women 4 years ago in the last election cycle that men really have to be put aside? They're dangerous.
I'm not allowed to discuss our meetings. I'm not at liberty to say, but I did mean what I said with the guns. And,
no, but seriously, because I don't know if...
But the way you're phrasing the question, it's in a very kind of paranoid light. Yeah. It's like, you know, it would be like, did women realize that a lot of men are clueless and they have to deal accordingly? But you're like, no, did they realize that all men have to be put aside as if that's the only solution? You know?
Well, with climate change, I mean, it's getting pretty scary.
Mm-hmm.
Do you get a sense that we really are the problem?
Yes. But I don't think that started 4 years ago. I think we now
have the tools to take down the patriarchy.
I mean, I don't...
Not you.
Right.
Yeah.
Oh, good.
But we are the
problem. Like,
but
I packed kind of like,
seriously, but we are the problem, right?
Well, I don't. I mean, historically, you've been the only option. So it's hard to say if we would do a better job because we haven't had that opportunity.
Men have had the power. Right. So, of course, they have done the damage.
Yeah. Of course, you're going to get all the consequences of your actions because you're the only ones who have taken actions.
Okay.
So, I mean, and there are, I mean, of course, you know, not all men, you know, that's ludicrous. But, yeah, certainly.
Michael Moore has a new documentary and it's a masterpiece. Mm-hmm. It really is.
What's it called?
Who Should We Invade Next? Mm. I saw a screening of it. And he talks about, he isolates various parts of the world and what they're doing right and what America should appropriate from other countries. Goes to Iceland, which is, their financial sector was destroyed by men. And they did some studies that testosterone is what drives Wall Street, and testosterone makes it impossible for men to understand what risk really means. And the only investors in Iceland who didn't go belly up were these women investors. Mm. And he concludes the movie by saying the only solution to the world's problems are women.
Well, it sounds brilliant.
I'm being serious.
I'm being serious, too.
Okay, so now then again,
man, imagine how great a documentary a woman could have made.
I'm just thinking.
Actually, Michael Moore is a woman.
Oh, fair enough.
I'm just trying to think how thinner he'd be if his last name wasn't Moore. But sorry, it has nothing to do with anything. I was trying to impress Mike.
I don't get it. No.
But he is the message of Michael Moore's new movie is
hand it over to women.
Hand it over to women.
Great, we'll take it. We'll take it from here.
But seriously,
I love. There's plenty of us to do all the work. We're totally ready for this.
And what is the difference? Is it that you will work better together? You have a better sense of community than men do?
Oh, I don't know. Because I don't know what it's like to be a man specifically, but I think it's worth a shot.
There are fewer female sociopaths, I believe.
Huh?
Well, yeah, but there's fewer people looking into, like, you know, the mental state of women, too.
That's true.
Like, attention deficit disorder is, like, predominantly been prescribed as boys, you know, because boys are crazy and girls display it in a different way and people just let those girls go without it. And maybe ADD is fake anyway. That's what I kind of think. But in general, men are the one getting
the attention.
Were
you talking about something?
Mm-hmm.
I was just wrapping up.
No, I was doing an ADD joke.
Right, gotcha. I thought it was another one of those women jokes.
Okay.
It was a real crossover episode.
Are you going to be in the ADD telethon? It's 2 minutes every night over the next 6 months.
Go ahead.
I mean, I'm not a women's studies major. I'm the least educated feminist there is. I'm going off the gut here, so I don't really have these like highly thought out answers about whether or not women can run the world without you, but my gut is saying yes.
Women always listen to their guts.
Would, all right, now I'm not stupid. Like I always.
Well,
would.
That is usually
for this
what
next question.
Right. Okay.
All right. I know that Hillary is 69 years old. So, you know,
my God,
someone's got to throw her a bone, man.
So they talk about the, you know, menstrual cycle. It's she's so going to get pregnant,
yeah.
Right? Isn't she? She's not going to have to
pregnant
wear,
with brilliant ideas.
I mean, Hillary's going to have. What about when she gets her period? That's so stupid. A woman her age is going to want to have a baby with Bill,
right?
And pregnant women don't have periods.
That's right. You're right. We've got at least 9 months of solid focus.
I tried that on stage. No, it doesn't work. The joke is that I'm so stupid. I think.
It's been so long since you set that up.
Now I'm not stupid, but a 69-year-old woman has periods, and now the rest of the joke happens.
Do you think there'd be wars if you were in charge? Do you have
me
rage?
Me personally?
Do you have rage?
No, I
do you
no.
have masculine rage?
I definitely
What is the difference between masculine rage and feminine rage?
I don't well physiologically, I mean, testosterone, I think, feel right.
But do women have testosterone?
Some.
They do have some. Some have more than others.
Do men have estrogen?
Yeah.
Oh, my God. He was going to say it like that anyway.
Man,
some coffee.
I'll get you some coffee, Mike.
Do men have estrogen?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah. And women have testosterone.
That's right.
And does testosterone create violence?
That's what
yes.
a lot of science has shown. Yeah.
Are there women who shoot up
heroin?
Are there any heroines?
There have been some major female junkies in our lifetime. Mm-hmm.
No, we're not taking guns and blowing down schools. It's never been us. We're not terrorists. We're not any of those people.
Even with suicide, like, men are more likely to use guns and women are more likely to use pills or something that will be less immediately effective.
Something easier to clean up for the
Have at it. I'm interested in this. No, seriously. So men... women don't shoot up shopping malls.
No.
They shop up shooting malls.
Name one mass shooter who's a woman.
The one from San Bernardino.
What? Yeah, but did she actually have the gun, though?
I think she had. I think it was both of them.
Ah.
But that, it's great to see the glass ceilings always being broken.
I mean, that might actually be something.
But that's ISIS. That's different from what we're talking about.
Right. Mm-hmm.
So we don't have, they're not mass shooters.
I mean, if women are an ISIS shooting, I think that is relevant to what we're talking about.
And there are female serial killers. There's one, Emo Phillips talked about one in one of his old acts, Carla Faye Tucker.
She was the one she supposedly turned Christian and they were trying to get her sentence commuted. And,
yeah, he killed, it.
She killed 37 people or something, I think.
No, I don't think it was...
she stabbed somebody 37 times, and each time got an orgasm. That was his joke.
It was multiple.
Yeah. I mean, like, mental illness is obviously not discreet to men.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But violence, it's definitely, coming out of your hormone makers, you know? I'm a scientist.
The hormone makers.
Right?
Mm-hmm. Okay.
I've known plenty of violent women, but
How do you explain, like, Ronda Rousey?
Who's that?
She's the MMA fighter.
Yeah.
Ooh. I mean, women can be aggressive, obviously, and violent. I personally know, like, multiple people. If you look up domestic violence statistics, women have a not insignificant percentage of that.
There are billions of people, so there are going to be some Ronda Rouseys.
Right.
Like, there's going to be atypical,
It's probably just because we haven't had the opportunity to be violent, and I'm saying, let's give us a chance.
But that's what I'm wondering. Like, if you're put in a position where you can commit horrible, horrible crimes, but you don't. I mean, you could go buy a gun and not, you don't go in and buy a gun, right?
Thanks. Yeah. Thanks for not.
Yeah, you're welcome.
Do you get tired of talking? Like, right now...
Next.
It's three guys and one female.
Mm-hmm.
Do you get tired of being a woman, like, in a group setting like this?
Oh. I mean, I guess if it was three different men?
Because you are kind of being called upon to give the official word on what women
think. Does that make
you
angry?
I mean, I'm never going to be angry that someone's giving me the opportunity to pontificate like an asshole, just like any of you guys get to. But, no, obviously I don't think I speak for people and it's frustrating. I don't know. I'm not a scientist.
I do 150 episodes a year.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And they were all tonight.
Mm-hmm.
Is this enough conversation about women's issues for the year?
Oh, for the year? What do we got, like a week left? Okay, don't enjoy your holiday. We'll see you back in 2016.
I think there are a lot of things that I thought I knew about race and feminism. And
so is the whole point of this that it was okay for the black person to interrupt Bernie Sanders?
Yeah. Yeah.
It's certainly okay.
Mm-hmm. I don't know.
They weren't breaking laws.
Shoot them all, you know what I mean?
But you know what? With the... they had the whole thing with the... Black Lives Matter and Bernie Sanders. And then not long after that, there was tape of them confronting Hillary Clinton, and it ended up being like one of the greatest things Hillary Clinton has ever said, as far as I'm concerned, is one of the people was saying, do you think you can change people's hearts? And she said, no, I don't believe I can change people's hearts. I believe I can change the laws, you know, that bring more justice and more equality. And I thought that was like one of the smartest things I heard her say.
And I think once you change the laws, you change their hearts.
Well, then you get new people who grow up with those laws. And like the way that when you smile when you're sad, it makes your brain happy anyway.
Right.
Like it'll make people's brains better. Like the way the people today who are like anti-socialism, like don't give us health care, but they're like, but also don't take away my Social Security or schools everything that we've had. Like keep the stuff that we've had. So eventually in 20 years, the Obamacare will be stuff that we've had and people will be like, okay, so that's all the stuff we have. And then, you know, everybody who disagrees
with
the
idea is hopefully with Obamacare is that it isn't single payer, but hopefully it'll lead to single payer down the road. But you know, people who, one of the bandwagons as far as like making fun of certain kinds of people that I don't generally hop on board is millennials, how fucked up millennials are, because the reason there is less racism now and there is marriage equality now is because of millennials have grown up around all of that. They're the least, racist and the least, they're the least Trump-like people that there are, because they come from this newer generation that grew up knowing gay people and, you know, and knowing like mixed marriages and stuff like that. So in that sense, millennials have been very,
well, we have a millennial valuable. Here.
Are you guys millennials?
I'm not.
I technically am.
You are.
I'm straddling that border.
You're on the cusp.
Let's ask a millennial.
Well, I wouldn't. Myq is like really racist, but other than that,
but for the good people,
What do you think?
What, that millennials are?
But only answer this question as a millennial and not a woman.
Okay, what's the question?
Were you?
I'm
raised?
Really high right now.
I like a lot of millennials.
But
they accept drugs
as
more.
As a millennial, do you think you were raised in an environment that's more accepting of what's wrong with people?
I don't think that's because I was a millennial.
That was
a
funny question. Oh. Okay. Mm-hmm. No, but do you think you were more accepting of people's differences?
I think my parents raised me to think that it wasn't. It was coming from their generation, so they were already on board
hippie
with that.
Free love stuff.
Yeah, they're you know that hippie type. So they were already on board.
There were more people that were likely to be like that at that time, and thus it's all gradual combination.
I wasn't a first adopter of that of
right
of
and kids. Millennials who are kids of hippies, that probably has contributed to what I'm talking about.
Yeah.
Is the fact.
So,
that
but I was maybe
they're brought
too,
up under that.
Well, the argument
attitude. And people
that.
Like Trump, you know, he's like 16. He comes from the previous era when everything was separate. You know. And, you know, when I was, Trump is like 10 years older than I am. And when I was born, there was still, Eisenhower was president. There was still a lot of racial discrimination and women's lib didn't come until 1970. And it didn't really make its way into the mainstream of society until decades. It took decades for there to be any progress with that. So people from Trump's generation are just used to that kind of way of society used to be. And I think younger people they're more open to just the idea that we're a very assimilated culture.
The argument against millennials is that when you're young, you're more accepting of people who are different. But as you get older, you become rigid and only want to surround yourself with your own kind. You look distraught.
Yeah, no, sorry. I thought I heard something in my headphones, but go ahead. I'm sorry. Say it again.
I heard it.
Okay.
That when you're young, you're a liberal.
Yeah.
Like a majority.
That wouldn't
the,
be any
the
different.
The hippie turned yuppie.
Yeah, why would that be? But that wouldn't be any different for millennials than any other generation.
Well, a lot of the guys from the 60s turned out to be sexist, racist, Republicans. You know, the people with the long hair.
Did, yeah.
So do you think.
Not all of them, though. Some of them did.
Right, but
well, we won't know until 50 years from now when the millennials are old, mm-hmm. but I don't think they're going to turn racist.
I don't think that's the case. Now more than ever, we have the exposure to other cultures. So that's like something you're going to grow with and take with you.
I'm going to ask you one final question. Women's liberation, mm-hmm. feminism.
I'm for it.
Yes or no?
Yes.
Yeah, you're nay.
Started to come to fruition in the 70s, around the same time that the economy experienced wage inequality and our wages weren't growing. So at the same time that women were going into the workplace, men were unable, were not able to support their family anymore. So it became necessary for women to join the workplace.
Also, the pill had just come out. So
it seems like Advil? A coincidence, yeah. But maybe that is the dark of really sinister Illuminati plot to be like, okay, we'll give you women in the workplace, but now everyone's getting paid less, and now
but supply and demand, so there became twice as many workers.
The female Illuminati were like, this is how we're going to get women in the workplace.
There's twice as many women in the workplace.
Drove down
wages.
Well, I mean, you have to assume that's true because women still don't make as much as men. So we already know they drove down wages at least for themselves.
Because employers were like, oh, I can get this woman who's good, very competent, and I can get her for less money than the other guy.
Right.
But it was men doing that.
Yeah.
Okay, now, we all agree that work sucks, right?
Sure.
That for the most part, you rather stay home and watch your stories.
I like work.
I like to work too, but you rather...
We all agree, Mike.
I gotta go. Yeah. I have to actually get to a show and go work now.
Oh, okay. But... So. If you didn't have to work, mm-hmm. would you work? In other words, you could have a hobby.
I would, but I wouldn't be concerned about the bottom line. You know? Is that work? I don't know.
In other words, there are going to be some conservatives, some, and we'll wrap it up. I know you have to get to a show. But could you imagine a life, I could, where I'm being kept and I stay home? And I get to pursue my hobbies, and then I wait for my husband to come home, and I'm put on my negligee. And
sounds like you need to drive into Gloria Swanson's driveway in Sunset Boulevard.
You're saying we blew it.
No. I'm just saying, could you imagine?
that's the direction it's going. You're saying we blew it. That's what we had in your theory, but it's never that simple.
Threat of violence, no freedom, economically, financially.
I'm playing Satan's advocate here.
Right. No, obviously that was terrible or we wouldn't have fought to work. You know, like nobody wants to be
But
like,
my
tapped.
My impression of Micah, though, is that even if you were incredibly wealthy, like you would probably still write and still
I would be writing things and
you would do your enjoyable work.
Right, and I would be...
Suppose I gave you Milltown.
What's Milltown?
Wasn't that the pill before Valium?
No, I don't...
Milltown, I think, was the pill.
Oh, sure, if you tranquilize me, yeah, I guess.
Then you wouldn't
Viagra was known as Milltown Burl back then.
If you were unconscious, would you do any work?
Sure, yeah, you know? Probably not, you're right.
Well, this has been great. Great. Micah Fox.
Yes, three times in a row. Let's give a hand to David.
Was I doing it wrong?
We're just wrapping
it
up.
No, you've
now.
Nailed it. No, yeah. You've done it great every time.
Why, do people get it wrong?
You know, some people do.
What do they say?
Micah.
Mocha.
Folks.
Myq Kaplan.
Micah Folks.
Yeah. Oh, okay.
You're doing great.
Thank you. And I hope you'll come back.
I would love to.
Thank you.
Well, he's going to need a token woman next week, so...
Perfect. Micah is sure a token woman.
Somebody who smokes pot.
Yeah.
Token woman, that's right.
Mm-hmm. Wordplay.
J.R.R. Token woman.
Uh-oh.
Micah Fox is host of This Week in Jack, and why don't you plug some gigs?
January 19th, I am doing a comedy show at the Village Underground that's being hosted by Hemda Khalili of Keith and the Girl, and it's going to be an all-woman lineup. We have Bonnie McFarlane headlining, and I'll be there.
Can I get on?
Karen Feehan, and I'm sorry, Mike, but I believe we are full up.
Fair enough.
Mm-hmm. And I'd love it if you come out. It's going to be a great show.
We will come out. Mikey Kaplan,
yep.
Your Netflix special is Small, Dork, and Handsome. You also host
hang out with me.
That's
David
right.
Feldman is on next
Very
week.
Soon.
It's a great podcast. Frank Conniff will be in Minneapolis on New Year's Eve with the great Liz Winstead, mm-hmm. who we have to have on the show. Sketchfest, January
15th and 16th.
Podhouse 90.
Whenever you want to listen to it, it's there. It's free.
On iTunes. Tell me everything.
On Sirius XM, channel 121, 2 to 5 every afternoon.
With the great John Fugel saying, and we're doing a benefit January 29th, 7 p.m. at QED. It's called Keep Hillary Honest. We're raising money for Bernie Sanders. We pretty much assume he's not going to win, but we want to keep him going. We want to move Hillary.
So can we keep the money then at the end of the night?
Yeah, that's... We want to move Hillary as far to the left as possible. So January 29th, 7 p.m., we're doing a benefit at QED.
So this is a benefit that a Hillary supporter like myself can be a part of and not...
You want her to be honest.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, until she gets the nomination and then she can give it up.
Right. It's her prerogative as a candidate.
That's right.
Candidate.
I thought you were going to say woman there.
I know. Yeah. I played with you. And John Fugelsang will be there. I will be there. Frank Conniff will be there. Mr. Free from The Daily Show will be there. I'm leaving somebody out. Bonnie McFarlane is going
to
be there.
Wow, she's getting around, isn't she?
Yeah. Bonnie McFarlane is going to be there. I'm opening for Judy Gold at Caroline's Christmas week. If you're in New York City, come see us with Mr. Gondelman.
Oh, wonderful.
That's a great show. And what else should I mention?
I bet you, Judy, would let me do a guest set in that show, I bet.
Want to do a guest set?
I bet if I'll ask Judy.
Yeah. And you know what? I mentioned this on your show. If you have some extra money, give to St. Jude's Hospital. If
Is this a setup for a bunch of Danny Thomas jokes?
No, but... a friend of mine who passed away was a big supporter of St. Jude's, and it was vetted properly. It's a good charity. Mm-hmm. So if you have some money that you want to give, they, from what I understand, they do not turn you away if you don't have any money. So St. Jude's Hospital.
That's a great thing.
Merry Christmas. We'll see you later in the week. Bye. That's our show. Thank you for listening. Please friend me on Facebook. Follow me on Twitter. Please do all your Christmas shopping on Amazon via the David Feldman. Well, let me rephrase it. If you have to shop on Amazon, do it through the David Feldman Show website. Go to davidfeldmanshow.com and you'll see the Amazon banner and do some shopping and help us keep the lights on here. We'll see you Christmas Day with my crazy uncle, Steve Forbes, the publisher of Forbes magazine. Have a great, great week.